message as it was kind of been downloaded and into my spirit. I mean, just the fear of God came over my life. So I'm going to kind of back into it this evening. I want to first take you to the book of Luke, and I came to read several passages of scripture here, so I knew I needed to come prepared. Amen. I want to read several passages of scripture here with you this evening, because I want to make sure we get it and we understand it. In scripture, when there is a time and the timing has to be accurate and precise,
yes,
God rarely uses man. It's very important that you, very important you hold on to that. God rarely uses man. When there is a need for accuracy and precision, God rarely uses man. Look with me at Luke chapter 1. Luke chapter 1 all the way down to verse 30 through 35. The scripture says, "And the angel said unto her," speaking to Mary, "Fear not," he said, "Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. And he shall be great, and he shall be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David. And he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom there shall be no end. Then said Mary unto the angel, How shall this be, seeing I know not a man? And the angel answered and said unto her, The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the Highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that the holy things which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God." Amen. I want to encourage you, if you just follow along with me one more time, just go over to Matthew chapter 1. Matthew chapter 1, just a few verses there, beginning at verse 20. Again, speaking to Joseph. But while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, the son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary, thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost.
Lord.
And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus.
My God.
For he shall save his people from their sins. May the Lord have a blessing to the reading of this part of our scripture readings. You may be seated in the house of the Lord. This evening I stopped by to challenge your thinking. I stopped by to challenge how you look in terms of your life and your future. I stopped by today to challenge you,
yes,
in every aspect of your life, in your coming, in your going. I stopped by this evening to challenge you.
Right.
People of God.
Yeah.
To challenge how you look at things in your career and everything else.
Yeah. Yeah.
You see, it is not, as the song said, it's really not about us.
Uh-huh.
about him. So I want to speak to you for just a few minutes of a message I've entitled, Taking Care of Business.
All right. Talk
like that, Reverend.
To take care of business, it means to be committed to take it at hand.
All right.
And what comes with it. It means to be, to perform something effectively. Taking care of business, it means to do what is needed to be done. It further means to deal well with the need at hand and what needs to be done. God uses angels to prepare Mary and Joseph for their new life. Being parents of the Savior.
Yes, sir.
You see, that role of being a parent of the Savior, there was no textbooks as to how to do it and how to fix it. There was no emails and internets and ways of searching how to do different things, but they had to learn and listen to God. They had to allow God to guide them on how to be good parents to our Savior.
Come on.
But when he turned, Pastor, when he turned 12 years old,
all right, 12.
Something happened to the people of God.
Come on.
When he turned 12 years old, and I want you to look with me at Luke real quickly here. When he turned 12 years old,
yes,
we hear from Jesus. At least what is recorded in the inspired word of God. We hear from Jesus. Most of you are not even aware of it. We hear from Jesus for the very first time. There is no other mention of Jesus' life. But it begins right here. And I want you to pay copious attention and zero in on the very words,
yes,
that flowed out of his mouth.
Come on.
To his very own parents. Jeez. The very words, the words that could shock the average mother and father hearing these sacred words flowing out of the mouth of your child. The scripture reads in Luke 2 beginning at verse 41.
Yes, yes.
It said, now his parents went to Jerusalem every year at the feast of the Passover, and when he was 12 years old, well, we can do a message just on that alone, but when he was 12 years old, they went up to Jerusalem after the customs of the feast, and when they had fulfilled the day, as they returned, the child Jesus tarried behind in Jerusalem. And Joseph and his mother knew nothing of it, but they, supposing him to have been in the company, went a day journey, and they saw him among the kinfolks and acquaintances. They thought he was with them.
All right.
And when they found him not, they turned back again to Jerusalem, seeking him. Mm-hmm. And it came to pass that after 3 days, people of God, they found him in the temple, sitting in the midst of doctors, both hearing them and asking And when they saw him, they were amazed. And his mother said unto him, let me do it, back it up again. And his mother said unto him, son, why hast thou dealt with us? Why are you taking us through this? In modern day translation, behold, thy father, and I have sought thee with sorrow, with agony, with great fear, hoping that nothing has happened to you.
Yes.
And here drops the first very words to flow out of the mouth of Jesus, not only the words for his parents, but the words for us, people of God, this very evening.
Yes.
And he said to them, how is it that you sought me? He says, are you not aware that I must be about my father's business? Taking care of business. But when he tarried 12 years, God was ready to release him and unleash him into the modern day, the current day, society.
Yes.
But he reminds his mama, Mama Mary, he reminds Daddy Joseph. He said, weren't you there when the angel spoke to you and told you that I'm not like all the other children? Weren't you there when the angel told you that, that I would be not only the world's savior, but your savior? Joseph, Daddy Joseph, weren't you there when the angel came to you and told you, don't put mama to shame? Weren't you there when the angel told you that the Holy Ghost of God will impregnate her? Weren't you there? So why do you come asking questions when I'm about the business of my father? People of God, we have gotten it so backwards. Your most important reason for having a job, your most important reasons for existing today, your most important reason for being who you are today is to carry out the business of the Father. That's why we're here. You see, you got a job to do ministry. That's why you got the job. You see, you got children to move for ministry. You got a family to do things for God. But notice the message of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. He said, the Father's business come before any other business. The Father must be taken care of. So the scripture reminds us. And if you have one of those Bibles that highlight the red letters of Jesus, and you're following the gospel messages in a chronological order, the red writing begins to appear right now. That's when Jesus begins to talk. And he tells every single one of us this evening that God's business must come first. You may have thought your business come first, but examined, Pastor. I've examined myself. Am I truly taking care of the business of the Father? Or am I just going through the motion? Am I dropping a tip here and a tip there, but not really honoring the Father? God's business. In Matthew 6:33, we learn that we must seek first the kingdom of God. The business of the kingdom of God must be in your front center view.
Yes, sir.
The main thing, people of God, that we miss out on is that he tells us when his business become our business, that he'll give us the desires of our heart. And I've been around a while, Pastor, and I continue to see people pulling out their hair, trying to get a promotion, trying to get here and trying to get there. But the only way you can ultimately get there is when you put the business of the Father in front of your own. You see, there's so many things going on in our society. You try to do a Wednesday night Bible study, and the schools call all types of meetings. You try to get people together, and there's all types of situations that get in the way. But people of God, that on the top of all of our agenda, it must be the kingdom agenda. It must be our desire to take care of business. You see, there's nothing you can name that is more important than the business of the Father. Did you know that God desires to show his supernatural power and work in our lives? But the reason why we don't get there is because we're trying to do it all by ourselves. You say, well, Pastor, what is supernatural? Supernatural is things that man cannot do. And it's things that man cannot do. But so how do we get there? You get there, people of God, by making God business more important than any other business you ever got involved in. But God uses these angels. He brings these angels on the scene. He brings these angels on the scene to introduce something that is supernatural. How do you position yourself to see the supernatural works of God take place? By taking care of the business of the Father. Some years ago, our church, during the recession, our church got in trouble, like many other churches, and the mortgage could not get paid, and we were doing everything that we could do. We were serving God and doing everything that we could do. And I was in the office counseling with a couple, Pastor, and the bank arrives unnoticed. That's how they show up. They don't give you any advance notice because they know you may not be there. And the bank shows up, and the banker could see the expression on my face that I was concerned. I was concerned, oh Pastor, and it blew my mind.
Come on.
And the banker tells me this here. He said, Pastor, I'm not here to take your church. I came by to help. Amen. I came by to help. In the middle of the recession. In the middle of the recession, people of God. And he goes back to his office and they work out numbers. And they cut the mortgage payment in half. to excel in our givings. God wants us to realize that everything we have, He gives it to us for the number one purpose for ministry. I know you're not feeling that. The number one reason why you have what you got is for ministry. Your most important reason, people of God, for being here and still breathing today is because God desires for you to take care of His business. But what Jesus said here should have an impact on all parts of our personal life, of our family's life, of our relationships, because it is amazing. It is amazing when He comes in that priority top position, when His business becomes your business, when His ways become your ways, when His thoughts become your thoughts.
That's right.
Now you are taking care of the business of the Father. Did you not know that the Word of God teaches that signs and wonders will follow us? How can a sign and wonder follow someone that's not interested in the business of the Father? Someone said to me, "Well, Pastor, where is the miracles? Where is the signs? Where's the wonders?" And my response is, "Where is the business of the Father?" Taking care of business. When we take care of God's business, God take care of your business. I know some of you are not feeling it, but it's time that you begin to feel it. It's time that you see, every child of God need to experience the supernatural works of God all for yourself. All for yourself. Remember the story of the disciples that were hiding in a room after the death of Jesus. And Jesus appeared, but when Jesus appeared, there was only 10 disciples there. Uh-huh. And there was one that had gone his own way, and he had decided, this is my translation, he had decided, well, if they go down, I'll still be around. So he decided to go and hide somewhere else. But guess what? Jesus shows up. Jesus shows up. And then when he finally met up with the disciples were saying, "He's alive. He's still with us." But this particular disciple said, I know about you rascals. You're a doubter. You're a thief. You betrayed him. You cursed him. I can't believe nothing coming from you guys. But he said, I want my own supernatural encounter for myself. He said, until I can put my finger in his hands, until I can put my finger in his side, until I can put my finger in those nail-scarred feet, I will not believe what he was saying, people of God. He was saying, I want my own encounter. But the tragedy that is available, that continue to be available today in our midst, is that very few Christians have supernatural encounters with Jesus. And it's all because we're not taking care of the business of the Father. You know the story. You know the story of John the Baptist's father. You know the story that John the Baptist's father desired a son. But the scripture says that while he was taking care of the business of God, that once again an angel appeared. An angel appeared. that if you leave here purposing in your heart that the business of the Father is going to be paramount in your life, can you imagine something supernatural? Can you imagine encounters after encounters with angels and encounters after encounter with a supernatural God? Why? Because you put the business of the Father above your own. I've shared with my children quite often of the importance of evangelism, of the importance of sharing with others the hope that they have on the inside of them. You know, when I read this story of Mary and Joseph finally finding Jesus, I can't help but remember an event that we experienced. We were at Walt Disney. We were at Disney World. My children were, I think the oldest one, I think Hannah was about 4 or 5 or whatever. But some way, somehow, Hannah likes wandering off, like kind of checking everything out for herself. But we looked around. We looked around, you know, there's like hundreds of thousands of people in Disney World. We looked around and there's no Hannah. My wife went in one direction. I went in another. And I went yelling her name. I thought even Mickey felt sorry for me and wanted to help me find Hannah. Yelling, Hannah! Hannah! Waking up everybody, disturbing all of the amusement going on. And then I finally find her and she's just standing somewhere, just staring, just enjoying herself. So we've been keeping our eyes on Hannah ever since. Amen. Amen. So Hannah, Daddy is tracking you down on your cell phone. You know Daddy's still trying to make sure you don't get too far. But we can't bring you back. Taking care of business. That's the most important thing you got going. You see, well, Pastor, the children got homework. I can't come to church. See, we don't leave room for the supernatural God to show up and show out.
That's the truth.
One last story, and we're finished. I gave my life to Jesus at the age of 17. And there's never been any desire to want to go back to where I came from. And I was involved in a jail ministry back in 1981, 82 in Leon County, Tallahassee, Florida. I went there to go to school and ended up working. Pastor at that time had put me to work in the jail ministry pastor. And I had a studio apartment, and I developed these relationships with these inmates. And when they would get out of jail, they had nowhere to go. And so I started letting them sleep on the couch, sleep on the floor. And you know, when I look back now, I even wonder, I'm like, man, you were so bad. But I had an encounter with God back in 1988.
Yes.
I get called to a meeting at City Hall, City of Miami. Mm-hmm. A meeting with a city manager. And he said, I was at a banquet and I heard you speaking about the things you do in the community. And he said, I wanted to meet with you. And I was just very appreciative of this. True story, people of God. I saw the supernatural works of God. Amen. He opens up the organizational chart of the entire city of Miami.
My God.
And he says to me, he said, where would you like to work?
Go ahead.
Okay. Wow. And I'm like, this don't happen. You know, this is supernatural. This ain't me. He said, where would you like to work? And I pointed to him. I said, well, I think I know a little bit about this area here. And check this out, people of God. He said, what would you like your title to be? Okay. This is true now. I'll bring him in here if you don't believe me. He said, what would you like your title to be? At that point, I didn't even have a college degree. And I said, well, maybe this title here. He said, okay. And we got to the big question.
Yes.
How much?
He said, how much would you like to make? Now, I was still young at the time. I was only like 22, 23 years old. I didn't have it all together, okay? So I'm like, well, you know, I'm making $20,000 now. So if I can double that, I think everybody would say I did some good negotiations, right? And so I said, what about $40,000? He said, son, you see those ladies sitting out there? They make more than that. He said, I tell you what, I'll take care of your salary.
Amen, amen.
The supernatural power of God. And I forgot about it all. I forgot about all of this, but I was in Tallahassee at a meeting. And one of these deacons at the church that I was attending came and met with me while we were waiting for one of the sessions to kick off. And he says to me, he says, you know why? He said, do you know why the favor of God is so strong on your life? And I'm like, I wanted to hear what he had to say. I'm like, why? Why? He said, we talked about you at church. We thought that you had lost your mind bringing those acts offenders into your home. And today, there are some of them even preaching and pastoring churches and things of that nature. So the business of God is important to Jesus. The business of God is important to Jesus. Jesus hadn't even gotten into salvation. He hadn't even begun to talk about deliverance. But he tells his mother and his dad. He said, my business, the angels tried to tell you, my business will come before any concerns of this world. It's all about the business of the Father that makes all the difference in the world. His first words have to do with who he is and his relationship with God and his family. These words tell us a lot about Jesus, and it challenges every single one of us to step up our game. I mean, we got to, as the song says, taking care of business every day. Taking care of business anyway. Taking care of business. He's all right. Taking care of business.
Yes.
Working over time. But people of God, can you realize how you set yourself up when you put his business before yours? His business before yours. Some of you don't try this. You don't try all of these different methods, all of these different things. But how about trying to take care of his business and his business first? How about spending time in church all by yourself, cleaning and doing different things, because John the Baptist's father, that's what he was doing. He was burning incense in the temple, doing the business of the Father. And his heart, his greatest heart desire, Pastor, the thing that he and his wife blessings of the Father, he received his greatest blessing. John the Baptist,
yes,
was their greatest treasure. John the Baptist was heaven's great treasure that would be the forerunner of Jesus Christ. But he had a father that put the business of God before everything else. Can you imagine what can begin to happen starting tonight in each one of our lives when we begin to move all this other stuff to the side and say, Pastor, I'm ready to take care of the Father's business. It's the most important thing we can ever do. Let us pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord God, today. We thank you, Lord.